Very good morning to one and all. Welcome for the day 4 of faculty development program on blockchain. Today with us, speaker YV Subbarao. Let me introduce Subbarao sir for the participants. YV Subbarao sir is working as an associate professor in the School of Computer and Information Sciences, University of Hyderabad. Sir is worked as research fellow at SPIC Science Foundation, Chennai Mathematical Institute. Sir is also worked as a lecturer of mathematics in Bapatla Engineering College, Bapatla, 2000 to 2001. Sir is worked as faculty member in mathematics in ICFA IICDE from 2003 to 4. Sir is also a coordinator for entrance examination 2012-13 for the University of Hyderabad at Anantapur. Subbarao sir is also a coordinator for 2-week summer program on cyber security and computer forensics conducted at University of Hyderabad in the year of 2013. Sir is a reviewer for International Journal of Network Security. Subbarao sir, areas of interest includes cryptography, theory of computation, DBMS and data forensics. With this brief introduction, I would like to invite Subbarao sir to take over the session.
Yeah. Good morning, all of you.
Good morning,
am
sir.
I audible?
Yes, sir. It's audible, sir.
Okay, right. But I can see number of participants to be 46. Is it right to start, or shall I wait for 2 or 3 minutes?
We can start, sir. Meanwhile, they will join, sir.
Okay. So, before others join, let me start sharing my screen. So, is the presentation visible?
Yes, sir, it's visible, sir.
Right. So, today I am asked to speak on distributed ledger technologies. Okay, I received this call almost 45 days back. I mean, long time back, I don't remember exactly. But when I received the call, with my exposure or experience dealing with blockchain technologies for a couple of years. Okay, I started working into this area because of my PhD student. Okay, so I thought I can just, I thought just this is a synonym of blockchain technologies where I can just go ahead and speak. Okay, but before I continue, let me ask a question. I'll be more interested in seeing your chat responses also. Okay, please respond to me through your chat whenever I ask some question. Okay. My question to all of you is, choose an option among the two given. Blockchains is equal to distributed ledgers, is not equal to distributed ledgers. Okay, you can respond through chat window. Yes, Jyoti equal to equal. Somebody wrote distributed ledger. It's not clear. Okay, I am asking whether it is equal or not. Vandana Panwar, blockchains are one form of distributed ledger technology. Right. Okay, almost every answer is equal. If they are equal, many already spoke to you on blockchain technologies. I think I have very little to speak now. But okay, you can stop answering now. Hello, dear friends, you can stop answering now. Okay, I already got the feel of the house. Arup Kumar Chattopadhyaya, your answer is blockchains is more than a distributed, by mistake you type leader, distributed ledger. Right. Okay, got it. But Vandana Panwar, shall I know a little bit more about you, Dr. Vandana Panwar? You are from?
Good morning, sir. May I come in?
Yeah, please.
Sir, this is Dr. Vandana Panwar. Sir, I'm not an engineering student, neither I have any background in computer science. I'm sorry. Based on the understanding of the previous sessions, I just answered this question. That's it, sir.
So are you a person working somewhere or a student elsewhere?
Sir, I'm working as associate professor in management college.
Okay. Interesting.
And my area of expertise is finance.
Finance, acha, good. Where in the country are you in? From which state?
Sir, I'm currently in Mumbai, okay. Working with the Valinga Institute of Management.
Yes. Okay.
So only my interest in blockchain was I'm currently associated with the rural program, and mm-hmm. I've also prepared one paper on blockchain and its uses with the agriculture sector. So during that, I just read few papers and with a little knowledge, and that's the reason why I wanted to attend this particular session or FTP.
Interesting. Okay. If necessary, you can communicate. We can communicate later also.
Yeah, right. Sure, sir. Yeah, thank anyway. You, sir.
Yeah, fine. So that's the only answer which I can see is correct, right? Blockchains are one form of distributed ledger technology. It's not bigger than or it's not more. Okay. In fact, distributed ledger historically was there long back. One second, let me move on to the presentation mode. Yeah, I think the presentation is now again visible. Hello?
Yes, sir, visible.
Right. Okay, so as she rightly quoted, okay, it's not equal. But it's a proper subset of distributed ledgers. Set of blockchains is a proper subset of distributed ledgers, right? Means every blockchain is a distributed ledger, but the converse, I mean, distributed ledger being a blockchain is not true, not necessarily true. Am I clear? Okay. Blockchains are proper subset of distributed ledgers. So what do you mean by distributed ledger? Again, our understanding has to go back to blockchains, because that's what you have been listening to the past few days. Okay. And I believe many of you might be working on this area for quite a time. Okay. So we'll again refer back to blockchains to understand distributed ledgers, and then we'll try to explore what are other forms of distributed ledger that are known. Okay. In fact, my talk can be we'll be throwing some light on understanding distributed ledgers. It will not be exhaustive. Okay, within 1.5 hours, I can't make a complete exhaustive presentation of distributed ledgers, but I'll be giving you some glimpses of what it means. Okay, let me quickly recall blockchains. Why we need blockchains at all? Okay. You have listened through. Okay, I'll be asking so many questions throughout the talk. Please respond to me by your chats. Okay, why you need blockchains? transparency. Next, for secure transaction, tamper resistance, security more. Blockchains is a better, safer way to record activity and keep data fresh while maintaining a record of its history to ensure security. Immutable. Dr. K. Anil Kumar Reddy Garu, what is meant by immutable? You can give a voice reply also. To provide data integrity, avoid trusted, yes.
Tampering of the, no tampering of data.
Yeah, that's fine. Right. Yeah, one second. Ledha Kamal TOCH. Can you come forward, please? Ledha Kamal TOCH.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Avoid trusted third party. May I know you are from? Where you are from?
I'm from Kerala. Working as assistant professor in Tokachi Institute of Science and Technology.
Okay, right. Thanks. Yeah. Dear friends, all of you are giving me answers such as tamper proof, secure data and all such things, right? Couple of people along with whom I have just spoken, okay, gave me an answer saying that to avoid central authority. That's the main reason, right? Okay, just to achieve security and immutability and all such things, cryptography itself is enough. We don't need something called blockchains, right? What is visible now to you, my screen or my presentation?
Your presentation, sir.
Presentation is still visible, okay, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, my presentation is still full screen, right?
No, sir, no.
Okay, I'll make it full screen again. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So, blockchain is there to avoid third party. Okay, why third party should be avoided? The presence of third party, say for instance, when we deal a transaction of some X amount from account A to account B, you can't directly take your money from account A and put it in account B. You have to instruct bank, right? So this process can involve some cost. Okay, bank may charge you some service tax, right? And government may add to that some CST and all such things, right? So having a third party results in some cost. Also, whenever you might have experienced this, whenever you try to do some online transaction of your money, it will not be transferred immediately. Okay, it will take some time, right? So that costs you some time also. I mean, it results in some time consumption. Apart from all this, bank can control your transaction. They can say in a day you can only transfer 3 times, or you can transfer only an amount up to 50,000. Many such conditions. Okay, not only that, even government can have access on your bank transactions, and even they can control you. Right, many such control mechanisms can be a disturbing thing. Please, just a minute. Right, so to avoid all this cost, time and control, okay, blockchains can provide some kind of anonymous transaction which is possible. Okay. I think many of the previous talks might have explained already that blockchain transactions, Bitcoin transactions or blockchain transactions are anonymous in nature, right? Okay. My next question is, how blockchains achieve this? You can give some keywords in your chat window. hashing, yes. Digital signatures, hashing, yeah, they are all cryptographic tools. Good, correct. Okay, cryptographic tools are one important aspect of blockchains which help you to achieve what you are aiming. Okay, your aim is to remove third party. Cryptography alone cannot do this. Linked blocks, okay, to some extent, right? True cryptographic algorithms. No, apart from cryptographic, there is another important aspect of blockchains. Yes, blockchains in a way where nodes or devices in blockchain network can confirm the validity in this system transaction between users, such as sending, oh my god, I can't read it. Consensus. Sarika Kadam, you said consensus. Consensus amongst whom? Dr. Sarika Kadam, it is consensus among whom? Agreement among nodes. Good, perfect. Yeah, the presence of number of nodes, right? I mean, whether these multiple nodes, can they trust each other? Yeah, they are not in general trustworthy, but together they become trustworthy. Okay, that's the beauty of blockchain technologies, which you have learned for all these days, and you will be continuing to see them also, right? And how this is achieved? Through various consensus algorithms, okay, that will be presented by a different faculty to you, right? What is this? No, yes. I don't understand why this no. Okay, my question is all about, how this goal is achieved. Okay, either no or yes doesn't make any sense to me. Trust among nodes, okay, fine, got it. Okay, these nodes are not trustworthy, okay, but together they become trustworthy, right? And that is achieved through consensus algorithm, right? Good. Okay, we'll again continue with the presentation. I'll be disturbing you throughout with my questions. Yeah, peer-to-peer network, where there are number of nodes in the network. These nodes are not trustworthy, but because of your blockchain algorithms, where you have consensus algorithms and cryptographic algorithms, they become trustworthy. Yeah, and it also has some kind of linked list with it, right? And it has so many, that linking is will be happening through some kind of hash linking also. Okay, directly blocks are a linked list, and your block header has a backward link, okay, which is a pointer to hash of previous block, right? So this hash linking also provides some kind of security feature to you. Okay, I'll not go into those technical details in detail, okay, but in brief. And as some of you rightly said, public key cryptography. Here the name that we use in blockchains is elliptic curve cryptography. That becomes necessary for doing some kind of digital signatures also. Right, good. Together, all this put together, your blockchain becomes a tool that can avoid presence of third party. Right, good. My next question, okay, now I'm not going to break so much. Okay, I just want to know, what is fork in blockchains? Please answer. What do you mean by fork in blockchains? Dr. Latesh asked me a question. Can they trust each other? No. As a pair, node can trust any other node. Okay, but together they become trustworthy. Two blocks linked from a block. Yeah, correct. In some sense, correct. Blockchain forks are essentially a split in the blockchain network. One second. Prasanna, I'm a phone call. Inke the phone loan at me. Okaranim shall I? Yeah. Blockchain folks are essentially a split. Okay, copy of the node. Right. Okay, it's not copy of the node. One parent block having more than one children. Okay, is called fork. Okay, how forks are handled? Can somebody explain how forks are handled? When at same time, two nodes transactions added in blockchain. Perfect. Sarika Kadam, your answer is perfect. Proof of work, POW, like tree, correct. Okay, fork results a tree structure. But how they are handled? Okay, assume the fork results. Longest chain has to consider in, okay, proof of work. Perfect. Yeah, you allow both, okay, assume there are two children for a single block. You allow both of them to have their respective children, so they keep growing. After a while, see which part is longer, which stream is longer than the other. Retain only that and cut off the other branch. Okay, those blocks will be discarded and all transactions which are part of those blocks will again be sent back to the pool of transactions. Right, they'll again go into new blocks. Fine. Let me ask one another question. How long it will take to mine a single block? Yeah, longest chain has to be considered. I agree with that. Okay, how long it will take to mine a single block? Mining time that is needed to mine a single block. Depends on difficulty level? No, difficulty level is adjusted to achieve the time target. What's the time target? Usually it is 10 minutes. I will not bother you so much. Usually it is 10 minutes. Right, we always try to achieve the time as 10 minutes and we adjust. If it is taking more time, we decrease the difficulty level. If it is taking lesser time, we increase the difficulty level and we try to maintain the time as 10 minutes. Right, so you can easily do a simple arithmetic to see that will result in 7 transactions per second. Okay, do you think that 7 transactions per second is a really good rate? Not really. Okay, it's pretty slow. Right, let me move back to my presentation. Okay, this fork, you explained about it, how forks are handled. We retain the longest chain, right? And how this proof of work is related to fork? With the proof of work, you keep extending both the branches. One branch will become longer, the other will become shorter. The shorter is truncated and it's again sent back to the pool of transactions. All this is fine. So the minimum time that a transaction takes to get itself into the blockchain is roughly 10 minutes. Okay, if you are lucky, your transaction can be sent into a block immediately and it can be mined immediately also. Okay, but still the average rate at which the transactions are recorded in blockchains can be easily calculated to 7 transactions per second. And that is quite slow, right? If you look at any meaningful bank transactions such as Visa or MasterCard or any other bank transactions, 7 is not an acceptable speed at all. Okay, so we need a faster mechanism, right? How to increase that speed? Yeah, you can reduce the difficulty levels and see that a block is mined faster. If that is done, forks will become a nuisance. Okay, every time you will be having so many forks because of low difficulty levels, and you will be having discarded blocks and this will be sent back to the pool again and again. Okay, so that will become a real nuisance. So you can't reduce the difficulty and you can't increase the the mining speed of blocks. Okay, that can result in bad scenarios, right? So you need definitely many other and different techniques to really increase the rate of transactions per second, right? So this made people to look into other variants of blockchains, right? But please believe me, distributed ledgers are not a topic which came after blockchains. They were much before blockchains in terms of research. But earlier to blockchains, people were using distributed ledger for different purposes. Okay, this distributed ledger technology as a technology to provide what it's aiming, he started with blockchains. Okay, yeah, good. So what is distributed ledger technology? Okay. Let me, this quotes I got from some paper which I was reading recently. During travel time, we keep our money in different pockets and bags so that any thief can't steal all money easily. And in DLT, I want to write distributed ledger technology as DLT. In DLTs, several nodes in the network maintain copies of ledgers to make changes. Attacker has to hack all nodes simultaneously, which is difficult. Okay, if at all any attacker wants to change something, he has to hack all nodes simultaneously, which becomes difficult, right? Somehow I felt this comparison is a bit crazy. Okay, in terms of your money being distributed in pockets, if some pickpocketer can cut a pocket, you lose something. In case of DLTs, even if somebody can hack a single node, they achieve nothing. Okay, that's the beauty of DLT, right? Okay, so shall I simply assume whether DLT means distributed database that looks like a ledger? You agree with me? What does DLT mean for you? Right? DLT is not just a distributed database which looks like a ledger. It's something more for us. In brief, DLT is whatever we learned about blockchain technologies. A DLT is a peer-to-peer network of nodes containing full or partial copies of ledgers that we are trying to develop and that are stored and accessed using various cryptographic algorithms. Okay, so DLT is combination of these things. It's a peer-to-peer network and it is a distributed ledger, right? A distributed database system. And it also uses cryptography for its storage and accessing purposes, right? So that is what we learned about blockchain technologies also. Okay, now we'll try to see a bit more about this distributed ledgers. Yeah. So again, this is more or less like a summary of your blockchain technologies, okay? But we are trying to see it from a different perspective, right? Distributed ledgers, entities can be connected on a peer-to-peer basis via nodes, okay? You just have so many nodes and they are connected as a peer-to-peer network. In peer-to-peer network, is it necessary to connect all nodes? Not really, okay? There is some kind of connection between, some kind of path between every two nodes. It's a connected graph we are looking at, right? But it's not necessarily a complete graph, okay? Participants will have different roles or functions. Okay, even in your blockchain technologies, you might have seen this, right? Is every node a miner? No, again, not really. Some nodes are miners and some nodes are the user nodes where users will do transactions using that. Okay, they can be your mobile phone apps or something like that. And some can be a special purpose verifying nodes. Okay, some SPVs. Okay, they just do verification of transactions. How they do? They get data from, Merkle tree kind of, Merkle root kind of thing from a full miner node along with the Merkle path, and they do some kind of verification. Okay. Next, ownership can be stored on a ledger? Or, I mean, in case of Bitcoins, I mean, the ownership of asset is the number of Bitcoins that a person owns, right? So where that is stored, do you believe that blockchain store the number of Bitcoins that a user has? Please respond. Sarika Kadam. Okay, she says yes. I believe it's for this question. Okay, anyway, let me wait and see. What's your answer? Will blockchain, whether it stores the total number of Bitcoins that I own? Assume I'm a user of blockchain. Okay. One answer is no. What about others? Others? Somebody wrote his name. Okay. My question is, assume I'm a user of Bitcoins and I buy so many Bitcoins, will blockchain store the total number of Bitcoins that I own? Will it have such a figure? Yes, as many of you said, it will not store, it will only record transactions, and only my wallet can give me the total number of Bitcoins that I have, right? And wallet has a different private public key combination for every transaction that I do, right? To keep me my anonymity for myself, and it will not reveal my identity, because for every transaction it will generate a pair of public and private keys, right? So really blockchain doesn't know anything about total number of Bitcoins that a user owns, right? So in that case, the ownership of assets is not actually recorded in blockchain, okay? It only has information about transaction, and ownership is decided by the signature and corresponding private key, okay? Blockchain doesn't really store who is the owner of anything, okay? It records transaction in a particular format. Am I clear? Okay. Now, but you may have a variant of DLT. Say, for instance, if you are dealing with land registration, these days everybody talks about blockchain technologies being used in land registration. Okay, to preserve the documents of lands. Okay, there you have to think of a mechanism where you also record ownership. Because government needs that information. If tomorrow it wants to send some kind of tax receipt to owner of a particular piece of land, it can't go and ask people who owns this, right? So government actually needs details of a owner of some particular property, okay? So any blockchain technology or any distributed ledger technology that you have to plan for, such a registration process has to record ownership in ledger itself. Am I clear? Okay. In the process, you have to understand the same ledger copy need not be there everywhere. Okay. The ledger part which records the ownership can be a different node, and the ledger which records different kinds of transactions can also be another node, right? So different nodes of your DLT can have different pieces of data. Okay, if you recall my definition, every node need not have complete copy of the ledger. It can have full or partial ledger in it, right? All put together will become your ledger, right? Okay, so, and it can use cryptography to facilitate various transaction processes. Okay, and transaction histories and current status of ownership can be distributed across the nodes. This is what I have been saying, okay? transactions and current status of ownership can reside on different nodes. Yeah. Next, the protocol can define the procedures necessary for the asset transfer process. Yeah, you know, there is a particular process to transfer bitcoins in the blockchain technologies that you have already seen. Okay. Similarly, your land registry blockchains can have its own protocol, right? If you want to do a supply chain recording using distributed ledger technologies, it can have a different protocol altogether, right? So distributed ledger technology needs a protocol for itself, right? And application programming interface, okay. Finally, you need some kind of wallet or whatever it is to use your or to interact with your blockchain or distributed ledger that you are creating, right? So some kind of application programming must be used to create an interface which can improve your usability, right? Smart contracts, I mean, yesterday you might have listened some session completely on smart contracts, okay? And these are some kind of agreements which are there to automate transfer based on some pre-specified events which are agreed by parties who are involved in that transaction, right? Okay. And it's not just enough for you to have a technology alone. Okay. You also need to consider about legal perspective. Okay. Simply in India, you can't use bitcoins just like that. Okay. And believe that everything is fine, because Indian government has some kind of restriction on Bitcoin usage, right? So a different country may have different kind of rules, okay? Some country might even ban the usage of cryptocurrency, right? So one has to consider the legal perspective, okay? Not just currency alone, okay? For any distributed ledger that you can think of, you need to worry about legal perspective also. Even for land registries, okay, when one of my students wanted to develop that kind of blockchain, he started giving out his own rules. He was not really so much worried about how lands get transferred in India or in a particular state. Every state can have its own different rules. Okay. Say, for instance, if it is an assigned land, which was assigned by government to some XYZ, okay, people cannot easily buy or sell that land. Okay, there are some rules governing assigned lands. Okay, so when you design a distributed ledger technology for that purpose, you need to consider all legal aspects related to that perspective. Right, next. So, now we'll move on to see an example of a DLT which is not same as the blockchains that we are seeing so far, right? I'll introduce Nano, okay? I just called it as another DLT. Its name is Nano, okay? Nano is based on DAG. Oh, how come? I explained what is meant by DAG somewhere. Okay, right. Okay. This is based on DAG. DAG means directed acyclic graph. Right. Every user on the network maintains his own individual blockchain. Okay. It's not that there are some miners, only miners will be doing mining and others will only use something like that, what you see in your blockchains. Okay. Nano is not such. If you want to be an user of Nano, you can have your own individual blockchain which you maintain for yourself, right? And all these individual chains form a lattice, right? That's why we call that it is based on DAG. Okay, I believe people here know something about lattice. If you don't know, don't worry about that. Okay, I'm not going to go into those technical details, but I can quickly explain what is meant by directed acyclic graph. Can somebody here throw some light on this directed acyclic graph through your chat messages? Yes, directed acyclic graph has no cycles. That's what you mean by acyclic. Okay, this question can be too vague for all of you, right? You might have seen something called, okay, I believe many of you are from computer science background. Okay, stop typing. Okay, just listen to me. Okay, many of you are from computer background. Is that correct? Dear friends, just stop typing. I'll ask you a different question. Okay, because you are all from, I mean, many are from computer background. You might have come across a word called topological sorting. How many of you don't know what is meant by topological sorting? Topological sorting in your algorithms course. Okay, how many of you just don't know what it means? Okay, one. Okay, fine. There are some don't knows. Right, is there anyone who knows about it? Topological sorting. Is there anyone who knows about it? Enough. I got the feel that somebody here doesn't know about it. But who knows about it? Dear friends, anyone who knows about Jyoti D. Gopal, she knows about it. Can you answer what it means? It can be through voice also.
Sir, is it something like first we identify the nodes which has n degree zero, then we delete that particular node, delete in the sense like we just push that on top of stack, then identify. There are two ways of implementing this problem. This is one way.
No, one second. I am not asking for an algorithm. Okay, you are okay, fine in answering this. But my question is, what is meant by topological sorting?
Sorting based on sorting the nodes based on. Initially identifying the node which has n degree zero.
Okay. That's
then again, removing that.
Don't worry about that. Okay, don't worry about that. That's algorithm part of it. Okay, what you are saying will result in topological sorting. Topological sorting means you can arrange the nodes in a particular order such that all edges move in same direction. Okay, there will not be any edge in reverse direction. Okay, your n degree zero vertex can be kept at the bottom. Okay, some other vertices can be kept on top of it, some more on top of it, and some more on top of them. Okay, you can arrange all vertices in some vertical order such that your edges will always move from a node which is at bottom level to something which is at higher level. Okay, there will not be any edge which comes from top to bottom. Am I clear? You can sort your vertices in some linear vertical fashion such that this is a directed graph. Okay, so all directed edges will move only from bottom to top direction, not from top to bottom direction. If you can do such a thing, such a directed graph can be topologically sorted. It's not that every directed graph can be topologically sorted, right? But luckily, directed acyclic graph is a graph which can be topologically sorted, right? Okay, I mean, it means you can arrange the vertices in such a way all your edges will move from upward direction, will have an upward direction presence. You will not see any downward direction edge at all. Okay, so such a nice structure can result in interesting blockchains also. Okay, we'll discuss a bit about these things. In fact, I'll spend some time explaining Nano. Okay. And then I'll quickly conclude my talk. Okay. This is based on DAG, and this removes the need for, we discussed some time back, the proof of work, the consensus algorithm, which we are referring to blockchains, costing us dearly by reducing the number of transactions per second, right? And this fellow Nano removes that requirement. Okay, this has some advantages over blockchains. Okay, we'll see them also. Yeah, and some kind of mess up happened, but anyway, let me not worry about much about it. Same slide got repeated. Okay, these advantages are scalability, low latency, and power efficient. Okay, why these advantages? Let us quickly see. Low latency is what I'm speaking about, and scalability to increase the network size in your blockchains. Okay, I mean, who can become a miner? You might have already listened this. To become a miner, you need very high-end resources. Okay, it's not that simply you and me can go and become a miner in blockchains, right? Your struggle for proof of work needs so much of computation power, and you really need a huge infrastructure to become a miner, right? And also another aspect of scalability which talks about latency also is the speed with which you can do transactions per second. Okay, so that I mean the time needed for each transaction as a waiting period, okay, can be called as your latency. And Nano, because it increases speed, it decreases the waiting time, right? Apart from that, you might have also seen something called a priority of a transaction in your blockchains. Every transaction has its priority, which depends on the transaction fee that it pays. Okay, so it's it includes, every transaction includes some transaction fee over there. Means something like third party having cost, this also has cost, right? So even that is removed in this case of Nano, right? And for doing this proof of work, a lot of computation is needed, and that consumes power also. Too much of power consumption is necessary for blockchains, right? And that is again reduced in case of Nano, right? So these are some advantages of this Nano as DLT. Okay, let's talk little more on these other DLTs. The DAG, I mean, the directed acyclic graph based cryptocurrencies broke the mold that was created by blockchain. Okay, it has some fixed speed requirements, power consumption, all such things, and it has some very fixed structure. Okay, a linked list structure and all this, right? Mean one particular thing that we already discussed about fork. Whenever there is a fork, you cut something, some branch. Okay, it again comes back to your pool of transactions. Okay, such basic stupid requirements are all removed by this DAGs. No transaction needs to go back for any reason. They can all be mined with just simple verification. If at all it's valid, it continues to be mined, right? And you allow number of branches to grow because you are looking at a graph. It's not anymore a simple linked list, right? You can allow multiple branches in your graph, but the only requirement, graph always goes upwards. Okay, so every transaction can only create a new transaction upwards. It can't go back and refer to some old transaction, right? New transaction is based on some old balance, and it continues giving further new transactions, right? Okay, so this DAG-based cryptocurrencies broke the blockchain mold, and consensus, you use various consensus algorithms in this, right? DAG coin or byte ball is another such thing, right? This uses something called main chain, which consists of honest, reputable, and user trusted, okay, nodes, which can give some kind of witness for transactions, right? Such a thing as a consensus algorithm becomes byte ball DLT, right? Another DLT is IOTA, IOTA, which achieves consensus via cumulative proof of work of stacked transactions, right? Okay, it has something comparable to blockchains, but not exactly. And this again is a very good DLT, which is more suitable for IoT devices. Okay, means it can allow micro level transactions, so many transactions, and the speed at which IOTA can allow transactions to be mined is really a good one, right? Okay, so IOTA is another interesting DLT, right? Hash graph is a patented technology by a company called Swills, right? Events here, okay, are guarded by asynchronous Byzantine fault tolerance and some other kinds of events, okay, which are really protocol type events, which are guarded by asynchronous Byzantine fault detection, right? Okay, and there is another DLT type called Radix Ledger, right? This Radix, it's by Radix developers, and the consensus algorithm over there is called Tempo, right? Okay, these are all for some quick listing of things, right? Here you can see a comparison table in terms of transactions per second, along with what are different mining techniques or consensus techniques they use. Okay, Visa, the number of transactions that Visa card processes per second are something like 56,000. Okay, and in case of PayPal, it is 193. But they don't, at least we don't discuss about anything called mining methods over there, because they are again a centered database systems. Okay, Visa has a main server which processes your transactions, and it's really a huge one, so it can process so many transactions. Okay, whereas Bitcoin, as I said, does 7 transactions per second, right? And the consensus algorithm over there is proof of work. Okay, Litecoin is a new variant of Bitcoin, which, okay, not that, okay, this is another cryptocurrency that also uses proof of work, and that can have something around 56 transactions per second, but let's forget all those. You come directly to IOTA, okay, it says 1500, right? Okay, but its theoretical limit is infinity. Okay, this 1500 comes because of bandwidth requirements, because transactions are produced, can be produced by IoT devices, okay, and they need to communicate. Assuming their bandwidth is limited to some megabits per second, this limit of 1500 is given here. Okay, if you have enough bandwidth, this can become much bigger and bigger, right? And hash graphs is also another it's also based on DAG. Okay, you see, there is no mining specific algorithm here. Okay, transactions are just mined because they're DAG based stuff. Okay, here you can go up to 10 to the power 6 in practical implementations, and theoretically again it's unbounded. Nano is 7000 as implemented results, theoretically no bounds. Okay, Bitcoin has a new version of it, which is called Lightning Bitcoin. It can go up to 10 to the power 6, but that again still uses proof of work, right? Here there are some smaller nodes which are not full miners. They keep accumulating transactions before it becomes a block, right? and some bunch of transactions are grouped together and made into a single transaction and fed to the actual network, right? Okay, that's the kind of process which goes into this Bitcoin Lightning. Okay, so at this point I would like to stop my sharing mode and discuss a paper with you. Okay, as I said, I'm interested in talking a bit more on Nano. Okay, let me present to you a paper that I have seen recently discussing about Nano. Okay, I'm just deviating a bit. I believe nothing is visible at this stage except your Google Meet window. I am sharing a new. In fact, I could have kept this into my presentation itself, but somehow I don't like such thing. Okay, cutting a pictures from here and keeping there. Okay, I'm not so comfortable that. Yes. See, one observation which I want to show to you is, okay, when a transaction is received, right, it's just forwarded to the other and it is observed for its validity. How a transaction's validity is checked in Bitcoins, if you recall, first of all, it must be an unspent balance of somebody, right? It should be there in the unspent list. And secondly, your signature has to match. Okay, a digital signature will be verified, right? And if there is a correct match, and your input amount is larger than the output, right? And all these features are checked and a transaction is validated. In a similar way, you observe for the validity of a transaction here. And if it is a valid transaction, you just store and it becomes confirmed. Okay. And your quorum is given as confirmation, right? See, when there is a conflict, some kind of conflict, whatever it is, then comes the question of voting. Okay, then the nodes will say whether, depending on conflict, whether the particular transaction can be preserved or cannot be preserved. Okay, and there will be some consensus based on such voting phenomena. Okay, and depending on the majority rule that somebody wants to implement, a particular transaction will be stored, right? Okay, this is how the transactions are dealt in Nano, right? And yeah, just look at this figure. So an individual user can have, not necessarily a single account, he can have multiple accounts, right? And they'll be chained as blocks in a similar way as you have seen in your the Bitcoin blockchain technologies. Block 0, block 1, block NA minus 1, and the last block, block NA. But the one thing you have to understand here is, these blocks are not some pooled transactions together. Okay, they are just a single transaction. Okay, transaction is an action that is being performed and its encoded version is called block. Okay, this is how the block here in Nano is represented. A block is nothing but a single transaction in encoded form. Okay, encoding can be an encrypted version. Encoding can be a simple coding mechanism where you just translate into ones and zeros, right? Encoding can be anything. That depends on how you want to implement it. Okay, what kind of security features you want to build into it, right? Okay, depends on application. A single user can have multiple accounts, and for each account, there is a different blockchain, and you keep creating different chains for each account, and all these chains are stored in the user's system. Okay, it's not that they are sent to somebody and the miner will be storing them. They store them in their system and they send them for further storage to the other network nodes, right? And these levels of nodes come because of this kind of sending, right? A higher level node will have different, I mean, data from many different nodes from lower level, and they store there. Okay, and that's how this directed acyclic graph is formed, right? Okay, so let me move back to my presentation. I think I have really concluded. Yeah. Yes. Next. These are some of the references which I used, an overview of distributed ledger technologies and its applications, and some more, okay, which you can, anyway, I'll be sharing this presentation with you. And if there are any questions, now I'm willing to answer you. Vandana Panwar, okay, you asked that please share the reference of the white paper on Nano. That is there in that list already, okay, in my presentation. I'll be sharing my presentation, but before sending it to you people, I need to update it. Okay, I have to add some more references, right? And that will be a reasonably good list of references. Okay, more technical questions, please. And if there are no questions left, maybe we can discuss on some blockchain technology aspects where you are having any trouble in understanding. Okay, let me ask you a question. If you are not asking me, I am there to ask you a question. For supply chain with DLT, which DLT is more suitable by considering more advantages? Good question. In fact, I would like to say you need to think about the kind of cryptography that is needed for your supply chain. Okay, instead of relying on the existing kinds of technologies, right, you can borrow from them and you can design your own blockchain, I mean your own DLT which suits your supply chain, right? And say my suggestion would be okay, from what we discussed, Nano or these things, okay, my suggestion would be to look at things such as Hashgraphs and other DAG based stuff, right? Okay, rather than that linear blockchain. IOTA is more suitable for IoT kind of devices where there will be more number of transactions and this keep producing in numbers. I don't mean to say IOTA is not suitable for supply chain, but its application is more suitable for that. Okay. but they're not really so greatly different. These are all comparable. Okay, they, I mean, IOTA and Ashgraph are no, they just differ in their consensus approach. I mean, voting approach and other consensus details, they just differ very mildly. Okay, let me ask you a question which you might have learnt in your blockchain introduction. Okay, you might have seen this Merkle tree, right? Merkle tree. Yes or no? Yes, sir. Good. So how Merkle tree is used by node which doesn't have the complete block stored in it to verify a transaction? Do you know that? I mean, can I use this Merkle tree to validate a transaction without having the complete chain of blocks stored with me? If I have the complete chain, given a transaction, I can check whether it is present or not in a particular block. Okay, when I don't have the block chain with me, really I can't verify. But with Merkle tree or Merkle root, I can do that. Okay, can anyone answer how? How you can use Merkle tree to verify the presence of a particular transaction? Again, this question is, can we do it with hash lists or hash chains? Yes, Merkle tree itself has so many hashes. Using hash root. Fine. Okay. So what is Merkle tree in your understanding? Hash root is calculated by left and right hash calculation. Right. Integrated lower hash values. Good. Okay. So, what are, okay, let me not jump into asking bigger questions. Okay, yeah, we know chart window is limited for us to answer. What are the leaves of Merkle tree? Rather than asking for the complete bigger answer, let me ask a very simple trivial question. What are the leaves of Merkle tree?
The individual block hash values, sir.
Not block hash values.
Okay.
Transaction hash values.
Oh, okay, sir. Transaction hash values.
Perfect. Okay, the individual transaction hash values. And what are the parents of that?
Root.
Transaction 1 and 2 are concatenated together and again hashed. Am I correct? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Transaction 3 and 4 are again combined together, rehashed. Right? Okay. It's not the transactions themselves, the hash value of transactions, whatever are the leaves. Okay. You concatenate them and hash them again. Similarly, you concatenate neighboring at that level and move upwards, right? So in every level, you reduce the number of nodes of that level by half of the previous because you combine two and get one parent, right? After log n steps, if there are n transactions, after log n steps, you are left with a single root. That becomes your root. Okay, Merkle root, okay, which is stored in your header. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Yes. What about others? It's becoming a one-on-one, Namrata, Reddy and me. Am I right? Am I clear to others?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So when some transaction is presented for checking its presence in block, Okay, how I can use this Merkle tree to check it? Assume I am a node without having the blockchain with me. Somebody gave me a transaction to check whether it is present in the block or not, right? In a particular block or not. Okay, how can I validate its presence? One possibility is I can submit a complete transaction to a full miner. That miner can check it and he can give it back the answer saying yes, it is present or no, it is not present. But if you remember my first statement, I mean, some of my initial statements, I said, these nodes are not trustworthy. I'm not going to trust the miner. Right? So when I'm not trusting the miner, how can I do this checking? One trivial answer, another trivial answer that I can think of is, I can ask that miner to send the complete block to me. Am I right? So I can receive the complete block and then check for its presence. But that becomes a heavy load on network. Okay, I mean, the data requirement will become too high. Bandwidth requirement will become too high. Okay, and it is not advisable at all in transforming the complete block. Can you quickly recall the technique that is used in Bitcoin blockchain technologies? Okay, I'll help you. Right. In my Merkle tree, the transaction about which I'm referring to is paired with another neighboring transaction. It gives parent. That parent again is paired with another node of that level, neighboring node of that level, and gives another parent. Okay, so I'll be moving upwards. So every time at every level, I need one another hash value of neighbor. Am I right? Okay, so what I'll be asking the miner is to send the Merkle root along with the neighboring hash values. Okay, that is called Merkle path. Okay, once that path is achieved, given, okay, is there any place where I can draw? Okay, let me not worry about it. Okay, let me continue. Okay, so once the path is given for my transaction to which I need to check, okay, I'll be having in the path the next neighboring transaction also. Together I compute the parent. For the parent, the neighbor of the parent is also given. Together I compute its parent. Again, the neighbor is given to me in the path. Okay, I go move upwards. In this process, I compute the root of that, right? If the root matches with the value that is sent to me as Merkle root, that's fine. To this, what I need to do, I need to again send the transaction itself to the miner. If the transaction is sent, the miner can cook up a false Merkle path for me along with the Merkle root and he can still fool me. Okay, how this can be avoided? Any answer for this? Okay, I leave this question for you to think. I don't want to answer it. Okay, but I want to ask another question. That is, in my DLTs about which I have just discussed, Nano or whatever they are, right? There is no such Merkle root or no such discussion about any block header or anything like that. And a block is a single transaction, right? How about verification of these things? So how it transforms in DLTs that we discussed? Sorry, difficulty, threshold, comparison. Nouns value. Srikar Kadam, can you please unmute yourself and discuss? Sarika Kadam. Madam Sarika Kadam. please just unmute yourself so that I can discuss with you. I'll answer your question, nothing more. I need to understand the question, that's all. Madam Sarika Kadam. You said nonce value with a question mark. Oh, okay. Maybe you can type your, but okay. Nonce value question mark. What is that? Last question answer it was. Okay. I think I answered my questions myself. If there is any question that is bothering you, you can post me. Okay, if there is nothing, I'll continue. Okay, fine. So this Merkle tree kind of stuff is not there with us. Okay, how this verification becomes a reality in our DLTs? Think about it. Any answers or any suggestions? Chandrasekhar Kosuri, nice session, sir. So he thanked me already to stop. Right. Anyway, I'll answer myself. If you remember, each node itself stores its required transactions. Right. In Nano, each node itself stores its required transactions. And the lattice structure takes care of verifying the transactions that comes from the lower level, right? Because of this natural DAG structure that we have, we don't need this kind of Merkle tree verification or some other techniques that we used in blockchains to give us security, okay? But just simply leaving them as it is may not give a secured environment. This also uses cryptographic tools, right, to give security, right? My transactions can be stored in encrypted form at the higher level nodes, right? They can be along with the digital signature, right? When I send them for verification, I'll send encrypted form with the signature that suits there. The signature is tallied and accepted, right? And every account blockchain that I have discussed will have the final balance pertaining to that particular account. Okay, let me refer back to the paper which I was discussing. Yes. Okay, this picture. Okay, every account here has its final balance, okay, which will be there in the higher levels of nodes of my DAG also, right? So transactions here will have two, every transaction will have two parts to that. The money that somebody sends, okay, say the transaction includes some money, B sends something to C, okay, see this line, B sends something to C. This is the transaction which B raises in his account by subtracting that amount from his balance, right? And he sends it to C. There is some time gap that you can see because of this upward arrow, right? After some time, C receives it, right? And then C adds that amount to his account and his balance will be increased, right? So every account will have its balance recorded, right? And at any given moment, there can be some transactions which are not yet complete. Say, at this time moment, this transaction and this transaction are not yet complete. So that amount will be there as the transactions recorded which are not yet complete, right? And at any given moment, the total sum which is present with all nodes added together is a constant along with the uncommitted transactions. Okay, the total balance that is with, assume my network only has three players A, B, C. The total balance here and the total balance at some other time moment, okay, if I just add them all, that must always remain constant. If it deviates, there is an error. Okay, then you have to go back and check where the error happened. Right, such nice mechanism makes this an interesting DLT. Okay, just by looking at such interesting aspects of a new DLT that you are looking or you are proposing, your DLT can become a suitable DLT for an application that you are planning to develop. Am I clear? Okay, with this, I stop my talk. Okay. I think I answered some of your questions. If you have any question, you can mail me. My mail ID can be seen in my the presentation, which I can share with you. Right. Let me pass it on to the organizers.
Participants, if you have any questions, you can unmute yourself and you can talk to sir.
Thank you, sir, for the nice session.
Yes, but please carry on.
I'll definitely contact you for my further research and other interest in the subject, sir. Thank you, sir.
And apart from that, I would like to say one of my students is there in Maharashtra. Okay, I think Ahmednagar.
Okay.
He will be also very much interested in interacting with people like you.
Sure, sir. Sure.
Yeah. Okay, and let me also say the last line. Okay, when somebody called me, I said long back I got a call from the organizers to give a talk. Okay, I myself felt that I am going to talk on blockchain technologies, which is my pet area and on which I can speak for hours together. But on some other later date, when they again called me to confirm my availability on a particular date, I asked them whether mine is the first talk or first day's talk. They said, no, sir, yours is something around third day or fourth day, definitely not the first day. I immediately asked them, you gave me a topic which seems to be too basic. How can it be on fourth day? Then they said, no, there are many other people who will be speaking on blockchain technologies and their introductions, and they send me some program. Then I got confused and started looking for what is meant by DLT. Okay, till then I was thinking DLT and blockchain technologies are synonyms. Okay, and I must thank the organizers for throwing some light on me to understand that these two are two different things. Okay, my thanks to organizers and all participants who are patient enough to listen me. Right. And even I learned many things from you through these interactions which we had.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah.
On behalf of Shobha Bindu madam, I must thank you very much for accepting our request for being part of this program. I think majority of the participants are benefited out of your session. It's very nice and a beautiful informative session, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for sparing your time. Thank you so much, sir. Hope our collaboration will continue for further programs as well, sir.
Yeah, welcome.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.